Project.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back. Thank you for joining us this afternoon for the Track 5, Reviving the Handloom Sector. Through the discussions from various panelists, the track intends to trace the concerns and challenges in the handloom sector, shed a light on the critical gaps, and suggest strategies to overcome the challenges. We have two very exciting sessions lined up under this track, and for this afternoon, we are very fortunate to have Ms. Shreya Mozumdar to introduce the track. Ms. Shreya Mozumdar has been working in the development sector for the last 12 years. After her graduation from the Department of Social Work, Delhi University, she brings to her work an academic experience of research into the area of women and gender. She brings to her work an intersectional approach that looks at driving sustainable and inclusive development process in context of marginality. Her interest in crafting sustainable social enterprises and working with the most marginalized of artisan groups has brought her to AICA, the All India Artisans and Craftsmen Welfare Association, in the capacity of the executive director. Thank you, Shreya. With this, I hand over the session to you.
Thank you, Shruti, for the warm words. Good afternoon to all those who have tuned in for this thematic track on handlooms at the Livelihoods India Summit 2021. I'm Shreya, and I have the privilege and the responsibility of setting the context for the ensuing conversations that include a prestigious panel of speakers, all of whom who have distinguished themselves nationally and globally by their years of service, practice, and research into the handloom sector. I'm happy to run you through the track as follows. We begin with a panel discussion on positioning in Indian handlooms in new and emerging markets. We move on to a presentation of a dipstick report on the impact of COVID on the handloom sector, which will be presented by Access Development Services. And finally, we conclude with a fireside chat on the crests and troughs in the handloom sector, which will be carried on between Ms. Jaya Jaitley and Mr. William Bissell. These sessions will follow each other from 1:45 p.m. onwards to 5:05 p.m. We hope you will be with us throughout the duration of the track. I want to begin by stating the obvious, that the handloom sector in India has a long tradition of exquisite and incomparable craftsmanship. It is also worth bearing in mind the history and the legacy of handlooms in India. Khadi, we know, assumed an intrinsic socio-political identity in the history of India, owing to its origin as an expression of protest and proclamation during the freedom struggle. It was widely recognized as a driver of economic growth for the rural poor during and post-independence, promoted variously through special acts and allocations thereafter. More recently, August 7th was selected as the National Handloom Day to commemorate the Swadeshi movement that was launched in Calcutta Town Hall on this day in 1905 to protest against the British government's partition of Bengal. This location in the socio-political tapestry of the country aside, the handloom sector has also been one of the biggest differentiators for the economy. The industry provides employment to over 4 million people and is considered as the second largest income generating activity after agriculture in rural India. As estimated by the Indian Trade Portal, during April to November 2019, the value of handicraft exports from India stood at US $2.45 billion. In 2017-18, the exports of Indian handloom products were valued at US $353.9 million, making India the second largest exporter of such products in the world. Additionally, the handloom sector has all the attributes of a green economy, with its USP of being local, indigenous, culturally rooted, low energy driven, and socially and economically enabling for the communities who have held these knowledge systems for centuries. This makes the sector ideally placed to compete in environment-conscious markets across the world. Against this context of historical legacy, growth, and imminent potential, the reality on the ground for the sector is quite different. Attempts at enumerating the approximate number of craft workers in the country have been few and far between, unfortunately. Last attempted in 1995-96 by the National Council of Applied Economic Research, New Delhi, and conservatively so. Notably, the 2011 census survey form does not have any category specific to artisans or craft workers or any information on the handloom handicraft sectors per se. The sixth economic census schedule has included a question on handloom handicraft activity without, however, separating the categories and without broad activity codes that would have allowed for a more granular analysis of the exact number of handloom and handicraft workers in India. Research-based data to quantify the uncontested economic value of the craft sector, the handloom sector in India particularly, remains missing. According to the fourth All India Handloom Census, which is a frame of reference for many of us, 2019-20, the total number of households engaged in weaving and allied activities amounts to 3.14 million, majority among whom, 66.3% to be precise, earn less than 5,000 rupees a month. This is, of course, before COVID hit. Propelled by loss of markets, declining skills, and difficulty catering to new markets, we have also seen a large number of artisans and weavers migrating in distressed situations to urban centers in search of low unskilled employment in industry. This needs closer examination of what it means for the weaver base in the country, whether that has also been depleting or diminishing in tandem. Allocations for the handloom sector constituted 27.54% of the total textiles budget in 97-98, coming down to 7.3% in 1920. Allocations under the National Handloom Development Program have decreased from 604 crores in 2017-18 to 484 crores in 2021. In all of this, what is undisputable is the need to reinvest in handlooms and reimagine a more sustainable means of dignified livelihood for the weavers in the sector. I just want to end by talking about the aftermath of COVID, where some of the key challenges highlighted by handloom enterprises and weavers across the country that we have been working with variously pertain to cash flow crunches, wage losses, cancellation, withholding of orders, supply disruptions in the raw material value chain, and uncertainties regarding shipment, both domestic and export, post-lockdown. Initially, broad recommendations of support included the expectation of a stimulus from the government, including measures like reduction deferral in GST across categories, soft loans and interest-free working capital loans to aid production, as well as the easing of access to raw material supplies. We've also seen that many global buyers were also expected to file for bankruptcy or go into liquidation, which would leave textile manufacturers, including those in India, with a high dependence on American European markets with crippling levels of bad debt. Coming to the domestic market in India, very low consumer sentiment was being anticipated post-COVID, resulting in a steep decline in consumption in the present and coming year. As per an initial estimate by the EPCH, the handlooms and handicraft sector could suffer a loss upward of 80 to 100 billion rupees post-pandemic. Sorry to end on this depressing note, but the handloom track will seek to respond to some of these challenges that the sector is grappling with. From our speakers, we are seeking insights into practical solutions for the promotion, preservation, and positioning of handlooms, both in the consumer imagination and within the policy landscape in India. It is with this hope that I warmly invite all of you to engage in the ensuing deliberations and also participate by placing your questions or comments for all of us to respond to. Thank you once again for tuning in to this critical track today. We will be starting the first panel discussion in just a few minutes from now. Thank you.
On behalf of Access, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Shreya for setting the tone for the track, reviving the handloom sector. With this, we conclude this session and we will reconvene in 10 minutes for the next session titled Positioning Indian Handlooms in New and Emerging Markets. Thank you. We'll be right back.
नानी क्या बन रहा है?
बेटा तेरे पसंद की चीज बन रही है। हाँ बेटा तेरे लिए सेवैया बन रही है।
और इसके लिए
सब कुछ बच्चों को खिलाओगे, हमारे लिए कुछ बचाओगे।
मेरा नाम नजमा है, मैं जयपुर शास्त्री नगर की रहने वाली हूँ। मैंने कभी सपने में भी नहीं सोचा था कि एक दिन मैं रिक्शा चलाऊंगी। मैं बधी थी, मेरी ख्वाहिशें बधी थी, मगर अब पिंक सिटी की बदौलत मैं बड़े बड़े सपने देखती। ये मुझसे बचपन से कहती थी मुझे डॉक्टर बनना है। मैं इससे कहती थी तेरे दिमाग का इलाज करा। लेकिन मुझे अब लगता है कि मैं इसे अब डॉक्टर ही बनाऊंगी। अब मेरी जिंदगी की गाड़ी मेरे हाथों में है। इसे कितना चलाना है, कैसे चलाना है, सब मैं तय करूंगी। ये सच है मेरी आमदनी बढ़ी है, मगर उससे भी ज्यादा जब मैं रिक्शा चलाती हूँ तो मुझे सुकून मिलता है। ऐसा लगता है जैसे मैं कैद में थी और अचानक आजाद हो गई। मैं चाहती हूँ औरतें परिवार भी चलाएं, रिक्शा भी और देश भी।
Jaipur, the pink city, is among the foremost tourist destinations of India. Like most other urban centers, it is marred by burgeoning population and increasing pollution. However, a unique new initiative is all set to change that. The Pink City Rickshaw Company project is a unique initiative on wheels in the city of Jaipur. The beautiful city of Jaipur is home to some of the most popular tourist destinations of India. And the Pink City Rickshaw Company project presents a whole new vantage point to experience the myriad charms of Jaipur. Designed as a completely women-led, managed and owned social enterprise, the project envisages providing long-term employment to 200 women through their ownership in the Pink City Rickshaw Company, thereby ensuring their economic and social empowerment.
The Pink City Rickshaw Company was conceptualized with the idea of addressing the growing urban poverty in Rajasthan. We are trying to create a social enterprise. So this will be a company which is going to be owned by these ladies. Through this program, they want 200 empowered women to run the rickshaw company, run tours, attain a sustainable incremental income, and being shareholders of the company, actually run this company.
रिक्शा चला रही है। एक दिन कभी इनको भी देखते तो अपन भी यही चलाएंगे। नसीब में होगा, आज हमारे नसीब में, अच्छा लग रहा है।
one of the few programs that we have in Access, which is looking at women's empowerment. More importantly, this program is trying to seek triple bottom line impact. Through the program, we are trying to see if we can build economic empowerment of the women. We are also looking at creating a company which will be owned and managed by these women and will develop some kind of a social capital. And because we are going to deploy e-rickshaws in the project, we'll also be impacting on the environment issues. So for me, it is a very innovative project, and it's already rolling out, and there is a lot of buzz and excitement about the program in Jaipur where we are implementing it.
Some people from Access approached me and they gave me this concept of Pink City Rickshaw Company. These women are going to be the owners of the company in due course of time. This is something really good, and it would lead to empowerment of these women who would have never thought in their wildest dreams that they would be owning a company. The transport department will be very happy to be associated with this service, to provide all facilities to these women drivers, and if there is any issue, I'll be very happy to resolve it.
So there's been a great reception by the market to the product. Target market are the hotels who have niche clients who would want to visit all the historic places of Jaipur or travel into the walled cities. It's also a very nice looking rickshaw. So through this project, we are trying to elevate the rickshaw, which is normally seen as the last mile connectivity, to product for the luxury market.
I think the Pink City Rickshaw Company is a great initiative. It's something that has made the experience of traveling within the city, the sightseeing, all of that, it's made it really interesting, because I think traveling, especially within the old city, using public transport is, like, at least with our guests, it's quite a challenge. So this is really nice because it's safe, it supports an initiative that, you know, people really appreciate. So I think it's a great thing that they've started.
Tourists aate hain, bahut sabhi hotelon mein teherte hain ye log, to hum unhe apne rickshaw se ghumate hain, jaise Jalmer jate hain, Amer jate hain, Jantar Mantar jate hain, Hawa Mahal aate hain, wahan mein un touriston ko ghumate hain. Hum chahte hain achhi chale, mahilaon ko rozgar bhi mile, aur plus jo ye tourist aate hain unko bhi accha mauka mile, jo khulla rickshaw hamara usme hum photo bhi le sakte hain. रोशनी पड़ेगी, हवा भी आएगी, तो इस तरह से चारों तरफ वो देख भी सकते हैं टूरिस्ट लोग. इस तरह से हमारा रिक्शा बनाया गया और इससे हमें रोजगार मिल रहा है.
Well, I had a great time in Pink City Rickshaw Company. I love the design. I just love that it's like a carriage, so you feel like in a movie, and it's all open, so you can see things like first-handed, very close to you. So I really like the experience. I love the fact that it's a woman driving. It makes it so much nicer and friendly. And it's eco-friendly, so you also know that you're helping planet Earth. So it's great. I loved it.
They loved the experience because it was so new. And, you know, you've seen the rickshaw. The colors, they stand out. So even when you're in traffic and you're in that rickshaw, everyone's looking at you. It makes you feel special. It makes you feel like, oh, I have my own private service. So they thoroughly enjoyed it.
I had an amazing time with Pink City Rickshaw Company. It was an amazing tour, and it's such a difference to explore this city with the lady in front of our beautiful rickshaw.
This is something which a lot of foreign tourists particularly want in for roaming around the city, and this will provide a long required service in the tourist city of Jaipur.
So HSBC has been a very long-term partner with Access, and I'm really excited that in addition to the couple of other things that we are doing with HSBC, the bank has agreed to support this program, and not only Access but HSBC too is equally excited in making this innovative initiative a great success.
India, the largest democracy in the world, is still struggling to match globally accepted benchmarks of gender equality and gender equity, especially in its workforce. And while we're changing times, India has been producing increasing number of women role models, there exist pockets of exclusion that struggle to make the transition from the old to the new.
If you look at macro data, the workforce participation of women in India is only about 27%. Women in India contribute only 17% to the GDP.
और तो आगे बढ़ना बड़ा मुश्किल है जी. जिस जगह से हम आते हैं वहाँ महिलाएं या तो घरों में काम करती है या फिर खेतों में.
But it is under such struggles that human enterprise finds beautiful expressions. Meet the women of Chandu, who have come together to create a social enterprise that has not just turned them into business owners, but also boasts of products that match the best in the market in taste and in quality. Conceived and executed by Axis Development Services and supported by the City Foundation, the New Leaf project seeks to recruit, train and empower 200 women to become business owners in a unique social enterprise that manufactures and markets ready-to-eat savories under its flagship brand, Zing and Zest.
गोबर के गोसे बनाते बनाते आज हम कुकीज बनाने लग गए. हम किस्मत वाले हैं जो हमें ये मौका मिला. मैंने ये कभी नहीं सोचा था कि मैं यहाँ पे काम करूँगी. गोबर कूड़े के काम से भी अलग मैं कभी कंपनी भी चलाऊंगी. कंपनी में भी ऐसे डायरेक्टर बनकर कई बहनें मिलकर कंपनी भी चलाएंगे.
Once these social enterprises do well and the women get better aspirational incomes, their decision-making power at household level and at social level increases substantially, which can bring in a really social revolution and contribute significantly to national economy.
In the project New Leaf, we formed a company and a brand, Zing and Zest. The main focus of the project was to empower women from economically weaker section so that they can run a company of their own. Axis Development Services supported the project by setting up the production center, getting all the legal clearances of the company done, and by building capacity of the women members through trainings such as financial literacy, enterprise development, product development, hygiene, and eventually ensuring that the product reaches the right target market through proper market linkages.
जिंग एंड जेस्ट हमने इसलिए शुरू की, जो भी गांव में महिलाएं फ्री में घर में बैठी थी, जिनके पास कुछ काम नहीं था, उन गरीब महिलाओं को काम मिले और अपनी आर्थिक स्थिति को मजबूत कर सकें.
We make a lot of efforts in making the products and the brand to be powerful and compete with the products in modern markets.
जब हम यहाँ ट्रेनिंग लेने के लिए आए तो गांव के लोग बोले, ये गांव की महिलाएं क्या कुकीज बनाएगी, पर अब हमारी कुकीज बड़ी बड़ी दुकानों में जाती है. यदि आपने एक भी कुकीज टेस्ट की तो आपका पूरा डब्बा खाने को मन करेगा.
हमारा खाना बहुत दूर दूर तक होटलों में जाता है, जैसे फाइव स्टार होटल है, अन्नमाया में जाते हैं, और भी कई प्रकार के बड़े बड़े होटलों में जाते हैं.
Over here in Annamaya, we have collaborated with Zing Zest cookies, where I'm getting a very good response. We serve all our Zing Zest cookies with every single tea and coffee which we serve at Annamaya.
O2Earth has engaged Zing and Zest to create a range of cookies for a new retail store at Hoskas Village. And in the past, we've received very good products from them. And we look forward to receive a wide range of delicious cookies from Zing and Zest.
I feel very privileged that this program is actually supported by City Foundation. I am looking forward to this relationship continuing over a period of time.
हम इस कंपनी को बहुत आगे ले जाएंगे.
Welcome back, everyone. We will now begin our first session in the track Reviving the Handloom Sector, titled Positioning Indian Handlooms in New and Emerging Markets. I would warmly welcome the moderator of the session, Shreya Mozumdar, Executive Director at ICA. I would also like to welcome our esteemed guest to the session, Ms. Archana Shah, Founder Bandhej, Mr. Ravi Kiran, Founder Metaphor Raja, and Ms. Ritu Sethi, Founder Trustee of Craft Revival Trust. Welcome everyone to the session. I now hand over the mic to Ms. Shreya to carry forward the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Shruti. Hello again, everyone, and welcome to the first session of the Handloom Track. I welcome all our panelists who will be sharing their experiences on the positioning of handlooms for new and emerging markets in this session. I expect this to be a freewheeling conversation between all of us based on a few critical issues that I will, of course, continue to flag in my role as a moderator. Once again, to all the audience who've joined us, please write in with your comments and questions that we will try and attend to towards the end of the conversation. Before we begin, I'd want to dispense with the necessary formality of introducing speakers, although they broke no introductions given their years of experience and engagement in the sector. Ritu is the founder trustee of the Craft Revival Trust, the editor of Global INCH, the online international journal of intangible cultural heritage. In addition, she oversees the Asia INCH Encyclopedia on the traditional arts, crafts, textiles of South Asia. Ritu's research interests examine colonial, modern, and contemporary traditional arts and crafts. She has authored and edited several publications, including Embroidering Futures, Repurposing the Kantha, Designers Meet Artisans, A Practical Guide, also translated into Spanish and French, Painters, Poets, Performers, The Potuas of Bengal, among other writings in national and international publications. She serves on the advisory board of IRCI UNESCO CAT 2 Center Japan in India. She's on the advisory committee of several institutions, including the ICH Committee, Ministry of Culture, National Crafts Museum, and Hastkala Academy, New Delhi. Aside from all of these impressive credentials, Ritu is known personally to me as someone who is always ready to generously share her learnings with her peers and juniors in the sector, and someone whom I have often reached out to as a sounding board on all things craft. Welcome, Ritu.
Thank you, Shreya. Very kind.
Archana studied textile design and graduated from the National Institute of Design in 1981. While at NID, she developed a keen interest in the traditional craft skills of the indigenous artisans. She traveled to remote corners of the country to study, understand, and experience the vast variety of weaving, dyeing, printing, embroidery, and ornamentation techniques practiced by different communities. This proved to be a very, very enriching journey for her, and the unique skills of the people of various regions, their distinctive color palettes, and rich design vocabulary became the base for all her future endeavors. In 1985, Archana started a clothing company, Bandhej, a label influenced by the traditional textile skills, offering a range of handcrafted contemporary clothing created for Indian women with an Eastern sensibility. Over time, Bandhej has created a distinct idiom in its design offering, handcrafting sustainable fashion that has an understated elegance with a chain of stores in Ahmedabad, Mumbai, and Bangalore. More recently, Archana has published a book, Shifting Sands, Kutch, A Land in Transition, which is a reflection of her own personal journey into Kutch and her association of over 30 years with the land, people, and her craft. Archana, on a personal note, is someone whose writings on craft I follow religiously, as keenly as I'm awaiting the release of her next book. I welcome you to the panel, Archana.
Thank you, Shreya.
After graduating from Karnataka University in BSc Electronics in the year 1993, Ravi Kiran chose to work in the field of textiles and garments. For the next 4 years, he worked in a few garment factories and realized that his true calling was more towards handcrafted textiles. Keeping this in mind, he started a company called Barometer in 1998. Though he was not trained in textile and garment construction, Having a workshop provided him with all the opportunity to learn everything hands-on. In 2011, he formed Metaforacha with a clear understanding to work with local craftsmen, be it spinners, weavers, dyers, printers, and tailors, and bring them to the forefront. He strongly advocates transparency in business, fair price, pride in labor, and equal opportunity of growth for everyone involved in the value chain. Considers himself fortunate to work with various khadi weavers and weaving societies in Karnataka and being the bridge between rural crafts and the urban need. Ravi is someone I've met while working on a khadi study at AICA, and I have been struck by the simplicity and straightforwardness with which he always volunteers his views. I expect him to be no less today, and I welcome him on the panel. Thank you for joining us today, our panelists. This is a conversation. I did not want to structure this into a monotonous back and forth, leaving no room for engagement and a cross-learning between all of you. So I want to just kickstart the proceedings by asking you, what do you see as the key shifts that have occurred in the handloom sector in India over the last decade or so? Maybe Ritu, you can begin.
Well, first of all, thank you, Shreya, and I'm delighted to be here. And I'm going to start by presenting a few numbers. And as we all know, that the 2019-20 handloom census has been released. And I was, when I was thinking about what to say, I went through the census in detail. And the last question in the census, when they went around collecting the data, was, where do you sell the major quantity of your product? And the startling figure was that organized fairs and exhibitions account for 1% of the sale, e-commerce 0.2%, and export 0.4%. Well, I was startled because I thought the numbers would be larger. But having said that, I suppose this is where the shift has started happening. I don't know how accurate they are, but this was interesting to me. So what it also implies is that these are the people we tend to largely interact with. So it frightened me to think that we are interacting with just 1% who come to exhibitions and fairs or sell, you know, online. And therefore, it means we all have to work much harder to get others on board. So that was the first statistic I wanted to throw into the ring. The second was that what are the types of fabrics being woven? And again, that was very interesting because 46% of them are weaving shawls, sarongs, angavastrams, dhotis, lungis, and dress material. And this is exactly the change I think we will all have noticed as we look around us, that, hey, fewer people are wearing saris. And this is, again, a huge shift that we are seeing around us. There are more and more tailored garments that we see. And, you know, like everyone else here, I do travel a great deal. So for me, even when I travel to small villages in the south, is I see the school uniform there is of a kurta pajama and a dupatta. That is a huge shift. So the weaning is starting at a very young age. What that therefore implies is that textiles that have been woven on the loom, which are meant for draping, are now being used for stitching. And I and many others like myself who wear handloom tailored outfits besides saris and others recognize that we haven't yet taken certain leaps. And one of the leaps, which I hope Archana will back me on, is the tailoring of a garment meant to be worn as a drape into a stitched garment. And sure enough, within 6 months, I find it fraying at the edges. So For me, there is a lot to learn by dipping into the senses, because what we speak of anecdotally is actually laying our path for the next 10 years as to what we should be doing, what should we be tapping into. And the third thing I'm going to say before I hand over is I notice another trend, and that is that in casual wear, if we can assume that kurta pajamas are now the dominant wear and use of handloom, the dropping of the third part of the ensemble, the dupatta, in casual wear. I see that everywhere. That too, again, is something we need to flag for the future of handloom weaving. So,
very interesting, Ritu, and especially your reference to the senses, because while we believe that the data is also conservative, there is a truth in the kind of trends that they highlight. And I'd ask Archana to come in now with her experience at Bandhej, adding to what Ritu has been seeing as some of the shifts that you have noticed in handlooms of the past decade or so.
Well, I think there's a huge shift in what is positive is that handloom is now part of conversation, you know, which was not part of conversation. Media is talking about it. So it's getting a lot of visibility. This is just the beginning. And as she mentioned, it's, you know, the numbers that this involves is very small. It's probably 1%, but at least it's now in the public domain. Handloom, which was not something that people talked about, is now media is at least talking about it. So you do need, it's getting attention. What we do need is product development. I think we need to understand why is it not selling? You see, we have amazing skills in this country. It's most fortunate that an Indian artisan has not, and the numbers are in millions. So of course, of varying skill, but there are people who know the skill. There is a market out there now talking about organic, something that's good for the environment. So it's opening up. This whole idea of slow fashion is becoming popular. So, and we have the skills to do this. So the definitely the problem, I think, is product development. You know, how do you develop a variety of product? Because we have this without diluting the huge diversity we have for multiple markets, for the local market, for the national market, for the international market. So I think we need to bridge the gap. What you asked, what I find really, really fascinating in this sector today is that young women, educated young, basic education, but lettered, young educated women are now learning new skills. Just 2 weeks back, I was in Kutch in a village which had 100 looms. Not in Kutch, not a single girl is ever, you know, women have always been part of the, it's you call it weaver, but it's a collective effort. So women have really been part of the whole production chain. But the fact is a woman in Gujarat is not sat, except when you're doing patola, sitting next to the man, because you need two weavers, but independently. In this village of 100 looms, I saw more than 25 young girls weaving. And they'd all gone to school. And I think this is fantastic. I see women all around the country spinning today, demanding for money for their work. This is additional supplementary income, which is much, much, much needed in hard times. So I think there are a lot of positive things, but well, we'll talk, I suppose, as we carry on what really needs to be done in the sector.
No, it's interesting that you mentioned this aspect of more and more women coming into weaving and other ancillary work, Archana. And I was in the Northeast recently, and we were trying to conceptualize a project for silk women weavers in Assam. And through a dipstick study, one of the things that came across is that, of course, we know that Assam has one of the largest clusters of women weavers in the country. I think about 14 of the clusters are situated in Assam currently, and most of those clusters are women driven. But it is also a fact that only about 10% of these clusters have women who are organized into any collective or group so far, and they largely remain within the ambit of organized work, which also impacts their pay, their working conditions, their ability to negotiate for different kinds of work. So we can talk about this as we move along, but with this opportunity of more and more women coming in, there are also issues that come up which haven't been addressed systemically so far. Ravi, would you want to add your thoughts to what you see as some of the shifts based on the work that you've done very interestingly also with the khadi weavers and spinners over the last few years and the kind of concerns that have been brought to the fore therein?
Thank you. I totally agree with what Ritu and Archana ji has spoken till now. I mean, a small disclaimer is I'm not supposed to use the word khadi anymore, right? So I won't use the word khadi for various reasons. But yes, it's a, this is a
trade. Khadar is a new term. We should
yeah,
not use the word khadar.
Yeah, we
I want this original.
Reclaiming khadar. Yes.
Reclaiming khadar. So yes. Yeah, the shift has been, a lot of people have started taking interest in khadar nowadays, compared to last 10 years. And there has been a huge customer awareness. However theoretically it might sound, I think nowadays women, even in a smaller city, can actually talk about Thele Rumal. They know what Thele Rumal is all about. They know what Ajrak printing is all about. They know where Jamdan is coming. So I think that has been a big shift in the sense. 15 years back, I would not have heard some of my relatives talk about this terminology at all. Now many of my cousins and nephews, they actually talk about Jamdani and Ajrak. So I think that's a great shift. There's an awareness amongst people. However, they may not exactly know whether it is screen printed Ajrak or a hand blocked Ajrak. It's a different thing. But at least they know where it is coming from and how it should look. The second shift has been digital literacy amongst many of the weaving community. I mean, I can tell you the number of Instagram accounts and WhatsApp messages which I normally get from Maheshwars and Chanderi, weavers themselves actually, you know, messaging saying that we have this sari. So that has been a great shift. I think they know, thankfully WhatsApp has helped many of them. They can reach the consumers at the fingertip. Yeah? So that's been a great shift. And also there is an increased number of resellers, small businesses which start from home, almost to the point of overcrowding, but still there is a lot of businesses which has started in the last 10 years, which is consistently working on handloom and khadi. And there is also an increase of exhibitions. I mean, I'm talking about pre-pandemic days also. Many exhibitions which is actually focused on handloom and handmade and sustainability, things like that. Which is, I mean, for example, Dastakar Hath Samiti, you know, Dastakar exhibitions, or 100 Irons in Bangalore. So this actually opens up to a very large number of audience, very democratically, these exhibits. Because every strata of the society, women and men can actually approach this exhibition. And even if they can't buy, they can actually touch and feel and understand and ask questions and learn. So these are the 4 points which I see in the last 10 years, the shift has been. These are all very positive shifts. Now, the problem, I think we will talk later.
We'll come to that. There are many, but I just wanted to take a cue from what Archana and you both mentioned about one of the shifts being an increasing visibility of handlooms through various strategies that have panned out over the last few years, and a kind of a repositioning in the public imagination, so to speak. How much of that has translated or accrued into actual sales or revenue to smaller weavers and artisans is, of course, a question for another day. But I just wanted to ask you, what do you think has contributed to this repositioning and this reawakening of interest in all things handloom? Do you think that initiatives like IPR, GI, certification, they've had played somewhat of a role in positioning of handloom more strongly and actively in the landscape of the country, or are there other factors to speak of? Ritu, Archana, Ravi, whoever would want to start first.
Well, if I can just start here, because this has been something that is a research interest of mine, that how come in South Asia, we continue to wear the kind of clothes we do, whereas in the whole of Southeast Asia, there has been that incredible shift. So I want to start by saying that even 100 years ago, those iconic images of freedom fighters, they were all dressed in handloom, and the women all wore saris and they wore prints and designs. So we grew up with watching women and men we looked up to wearing desi, homespun, homemade, home printed, and by home I mean India, printed clothes. So that influenced us. We saw our doctors, our teachers wearing Air India, air hostesses, yes, all wearing desi clothes. And it was just a natural movement into that. So that played a huge part. And designers, then coming to the 80s and 90s, it was the start of the design movement in this country. And designers too, who tapped into Indian traditions, played a huge part, and they got inordinate coverage in page 3 and in papers. So that was also a huge influence. So all these things, I think, combined together, made it a large conscious band in us. But to come to the second part of your thing, where you asked about GI and IPR, that and certification, I don't know if that has played a part in the consciousness of increasing the, you know, the awareness of handlooms and handcrafts, but it must in the future. If we want to progress, nothing is more important than certification. Just to buy a product, take it home, wash it, and find its color runs makes you never want to buy again. And its quality standards. I'm sure we'll come to this at another point, but I want to reiterate it here that that needs to play a big part also. Made in India, you know, a quality product made in India.
Thank you, Ritu. Archana, your thoughts?
Well, I quite agree with what Ritu said. It's definitely the role of designer. I think the shift started happening in the 80s. And post-80s. Till then, the artisans had enough work. There was a local market for their produce. Also, this whole idea of design collaboration has happened. And then designers collaborating with the artisans to create product. It works very well. This is the best place for any designer because you can do small-scale production. So it's really at the advantage of the designer to be able. And we have all these umpteen diverse skills. So it's a great opportunity for young artisans. And that has led to visibility. Then happened the fashion show. So all this created narratives for the handcrafted sector. This definitely did not translate into huge sales or production of handlooms, you know, but it did bring about visibility. I think what the sector really, really needs is sustained kind of collaboration and work and constant orders for artisans to feel confident to be. So wherever you have seen a kind of transformation that has happened in a region or in a cluster is because of this sustained work. Designers cannot sustain because they need something new. So they hop, skip and jump from one to another. But they've been, so they have been able to get visibility, but this craft sector requires another kind of work, dedicated work, sustained collaboration. I mean, Archana, I can go on about it, yeah. But I'd sort of shift to what you were talking about, the certification. I agree with her again about quality and certification. The GI, I think, has created more problems than it has solved. The way we have done our certification so far is really not really helped. We've not quite understood because it's created small little fiefdoms and actually more clashes within a region. People who are more influential have sort of said, I can certify, the rest can't produce. There's all kinds of issues. Also, we've not understood that, you know, certain techniques offer certain motives. Mm-hmm. Extra Weft has done something in various parts of the country. The very weaving skill directs what kinds of motifs you can make. So it's the color palette, it's the distribution of the motif, but you know, whether it's Kutch or whether it is the Northeast, there is similarity. So you really have to understand the sector to be able to make. Somewhere there's a disconnect in the kind, the way we have formulated our certification. But you do need, I do agree that the right kind of certification, sort of saying, and also I think it's such a diverse area. So one needs to think things through, but something for quality, definitely. That who decides how you do it, because it's you know, the production is sort of so in pocket.
Archana, I take your point. Are being very poorly conceived of and executed in the country because they simply don't factor in the kind of dynamism that is there across craft practices, and it's as if they are cast in stone. But the case for certification is a strong one, particularly if one looks at new emerging markets that have increasingly become more and more compliance conscious.
Yes.
And how does certification in a sense help to benchmark authentic weavers and artisans also present their products across these new and emerging markets? The point that I wanted to take to Ravi is that because I know of your ideological underpinnings, this whole point that Archana was making about design collaborations, and the point that you'd made earlier about digital upskilling being a trend that you see, I think one of the key concerns for me is the kind of inequality that lies at the heart of both these aspects, even in terms of the relationships that are being eked out between designers, craft persons, artisans, and we know the challenges that are there on both sides. But also in terms of how do we look at bridging aspects of digital inequity. So much has been made post-COVID of this onward push towards digital onboarding, moving of artisans into e-commerce platforms. But how many of the smaller groups, the weavers, handloom weavers that we work with have been successfully onboarded? And what is it that we mean when we say being successfully onboarded across digital platforms? So this whole concern about inequity that is at the heart of some of these new ideas that have potential, would want your take on that, Ravi.
What we have done is we expect too much out of a weaver or a weaving community. We expect them to be creative. We expect them to work 6 hours a day. We expect them to do quality job. We expect them to do give things on time. And now we are expecting them to be on digital platform also. We expect them to be on WhatsApp, on Facebook, on Instagram, sell, market, talk, go to exhibit. What all do you expect out of them? You need a different kind of a, you need a different kind of a segment to
Absolutely.
Do the market.
Yep.
You can't expect everything. So please allow the weavers to do the job which they know best. They are fantastic. They are very creative people. Please put them onto that. This whole digital literacy and marketing should be taken by somebody else. Somebody who understands that very well. Somebody who can actually narrate it very well. Not in a very inequality way. I'm not saying in a very inequal way. Showcase people as much as product. I mean, product is nothing but material, right? I mean, so you have to bring people also, to this aspect of it. I don't think huge aggregators who bring a lot of cooperative societies, a lot of things would work in future because it is one more, Amazon or a Flipkart kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I think it is being small is very important. People, what we have not realized is handmade. Handmade could be very big in India. But we are looking at a cluster, it should still be looked as a very small scale production unit. We need to project it that way. Yeah. But I would like to talk a couple of lines about this IPR and GI, which I wanted to say.
Sure.
I still have to see a transformation in the craftsperson just because there's a GI or an IPR kind of attack there. So I don't think it has helped the craftsman much. In fact, Karnataka is the forefront of a GI tag. We have 24 of them. Yeah. So right from Mysore Sirup to Mysore Pak, we have everything for GI tag. But it has not helped, right? So we also have a 1985 handloom reservation bill, which says that you can't weave powerloom sarees at all in India. It's an offense to weave a powerloom saree. So I want to know whether it's implemented. In the last 25 years, it's not implemented. So what do you do with that extra GI tag?
Yeah, clearly with the kind of policies and subsidies that are being pushed out of the powerloom sector, I mean, this is an irony in itself, Ravi.
Yeah, I always say subsidy is not a strategy. Yeah. I don't know why they think that subsidy is a big strategy to come up with that. You know, it's a last resort. I mean, if somebody is talking about subsidy, it means that you're almost in a death situation. Yeah. And we have been doing this for the last 70 years.
And I guess the point to be made here is that is an accusation that is often leveled against those of us who support and have been vocal advocates for handloom and handmade, is that powerloom also provides livelihood income generation for a certain body of people. But it needs to be placed in context of a separate market and a separate category of product. I think that is where the issues are with the kind of powerloom products that are flooding e-commerce portals, which are also displaying handmade handloom products at the same time. Where is this differentiation and why is this differentiation also not called out? I think that is also a key issue.
Ritu, yes, you want to add one simple point here, and that is, in one line, truth in advertising. Mm-hmm. Yes. If someone wants to buy a powerloom, more power to them. But yes. I want to know what I'm buying. I don't want to buy a handloom and then discover that it's a powerloom. And I may not even want to buy a powerloom and discover it's a handloom. So I think accurate labeling and therefore certification. And the law should be very tough on wrong labeling. Whether it is food, whether it is what I'm buying, because at the end of the day, it all comes out of my hard-earned salary. I want to know what I'm getting for what I'm getting, what I have paid for. So,
Archana, you had raised your hand. Please continue.
But you know, I think the really, I agree completely what Ritu is saying. And I support what the issues raised by Ravi, and they're very, very important. But I think the real problem also is that there is very little difference left between handloom and powerloom. You know, a lot of what is sold by larger companies as handloom, you know, promoters of handloom are actually selling powerloom fabric, I mean, clothing out of powerloom fabric, because it looks similar. So the owners, you see, the powerloom lobby is a strong lobby. It's got money. The minute something becomes popular, you know, they see some random designer samples floating around and see potential in it. It is immediately reproduced in the powerloom. And a lot of what you see in the market today is handloom, because it's a buzzword. It sounds good. It's, you know, you can create narratives around it. It's passed off, but it's not really handloom. So, and the powerloom people are not, and to me personally, I feel it's to do with the kind of yarn. The handloom sector will have to find a strong, unique quality, characteristic, a different, you know, why would somebody pay more for handloom, if at all you're asking, you know, and they should. But that product should speak for itself, no? So the onus is, I think one needs to... And that's what I mean, product and product development. It's not just creating beautiful patterns. I believe, and it's very, very possible to do this for the handloom sector. It would actually create many more jobs, but you need a unique identity for the handloom sector. Because the powerloom is not going to imitate. There's really little you can do. And I think policy should be that powerloom should be very strict rules that anything that is produced by the machine at the factory is stamped. And that chain is followed, because to do this, to expect it in the handloom sector is far more difficult.
because it is so diverse, it's all over the place, it's spread in a and they're individuals. But Ravi said, let the weaver do what he or she is best at doing. I don't mean weaver as weaver. I have a problem that the collective of people who make handcrafted textiles. And so the onus should not always be on them to prove. It should be, there should be some strict rules on the palm sector today. They can produce fabulous, and of course you need the palm. You know, it's not one against the other. But definitely this, you know, there has to be something which is left uniquely for the handloom sector.
So I'll take you up on this, and maybe we can go a little deeper on this uniqueness or USP, because I think it has a direct correlation to positioning and the outreach of handlooms in emerging markets.
It is a sector that we've somewhere lost it, but it's there. It's there to be reclaimed.
Ritu, when you spoke about truth in advertising in your vast body of work, have you come across recently examples of authentic marketing and advertising, a good practice that could support the outreach of handloom textiles in new markets?
That's a difficult question. But I'll tell you what interests me and what I think is a good practice. And for me, that is the acknowledgement of co-creation. And by that, I mean that if designers come in and they work with craftspeople and weavers, that the label gives equality to both. And in this, I would flag Meeta Mastani, who works with Chobundi and has for, I think, more than 20 years. She is a designer and she gives equal credit to the maker for their tradition and has done it consistently. So there are many like her. And that is something I think is quite remarkable, because it also shows a great confidence and ability in yourself, that you don't feel that something is being taken away from you when you share the limelight. So that reflects many aspects of things. The other good practices I have found is that when you do your work, you value the earth around you. So I have traveled, and I'm not going to tell you where, but I saw remarkable master weavers and master block printers doing phenomenally well, traveling around the globe. But I saw how they used water, and I saw how they disposed of their color. And it was hard to see. I traveled to another cluster where they were again, the master, the head of the karkhana, was doing phenomenally well. He had 100 workers, and I cannot even describe how badly paid they were. If it had been in any other condition with a designer heading that or somebody else, that person would have been called out on social media. So again, I come back to the word ethics, because the ethics should apply not only to designers, but also to those entrepreneurial craftspeople who have now risen to levels where they now need to follow the laws of the land. And I also have traveled to places where I've seen very reasonable effluent disposal. And here I will talk about Bridget Singh. And I will talk about Mala Sinha and her husband Pradeep and Bodhi, where in their little place, not huge, I saw how they disposed of their water, how it went in and how it came out. So there are many examples across the country, and I think we need to speak about both, because we do have one problem that I'm going to flag here. I myself was nervous of calling out the master weaver and the master craftsman. I gently said, you can't do this. The soil around you is indigo blue. No gloves, no nothing. You can do it because you're traveling around the globe. You have seen standards everywhere. So co-creation, ethics of production, quality control, putting on your label what you're actually making. Even if I buy a block print, which is silkscreen with it, no problem. I know what I'm buying. It is my choice. So in all these areas, these for me are the big points that will go a long way in building faith and trust in what we buy. And that is also the first step to, you know, becoming a true, a truly valuable industry.
This rings very close to home, Ritu. You know, we've been working at AICA with a group of fabulous leather artisans in Biavar. And they have a sense of sustainability and a very strong ethic ingrained in the way that they produce their leather. And we were tasked with the responsibility of developing their brand in a certain way, keeping in mind the environmental consciousness of how they produce and how they look at the process of disposal, recycling, etc. Now, it's interesting that what we are perceiving as having value and what will attract consumers, buyers in the external market is something that might need to be articulated in a certain manner to smaller artisans producing inherently sustainably in clusters that we work with. So a large part of the job at our hand was to kind of deconstruct what sustainability meant and to try and make them see how inherently sustainable they were in the work that they were doing and the need to pick up on some of these smaller things, the way they source their leather, the way they tan their leather, and how to highlight that into a successful and a better way so that their brand could benefit from the same. So that was an interesting experience for us in working with some of these smaller clusters. And I would imagine that if one spoke about positioning of handlooms in new and emerging markets, one concrete area would be to consciously work with artisans in these clusters and to demystify these big terms that we somehow seem to have imposed on them from outside. Marketing, branding, promotion. At the end of the day, it comes down to very, very small things that they're doing in the work that they do and how can they be better equipped to represent that in a certain way. What do you feel, Ravi, Archana?
Good practice is a norm, right? I mean, I always feel a freedom of individual expression is always a good practice for anybody for that matter. And thankfully, I have not been trained to be a designer. So I don't design. I'm really bad at designing. So I leave the designing to a lot of spinners and weavers and tailors and all. So they do the job, I don't do the job. So, and I agree with Ritu with the issue of water. And thankfully, we are safe there also. North Karnataka does not have water at all to waste. So we are safe there. So we use chemical dye, of course, very carefully in small villages. As you say, the sustainability means different things to different people, especially amongst the craft people. We don't have a local word for sustainability.
Interesting. Yes.
We don't have a word for it. Because it's been a norm. Handloom has been a norm. Maybe organic cotton handloom has been a norm. In fact, I would say if it is a BT cotton with a power loom, in fact, that fabric should be certified. Saying that it is BT and power loom.
Right.
I don't know why we should actually take that whole effort of actually going organic cotton and hand spun and hand woven and then have this problem of certification also.
Right.
Because it's a norm. That is how it is meant to be. So as long as we have a certification for power loom, as long as we have certification for naphtha dyes, we are safe, I think.
Yes, safe.
Certification has to change.
Right. I am. Yes. Archana, you were saying?
I agree with what both of them have said. I just sort of say, you know, people who work with their hands really do understand. I'll give you two small examples. You know, I was in Meghalaya in the Riboy area. This is an area where, I mean, like in most of Northeast, it is the women who do the dyeing, the spinning, the weaving. It's the women, it's textiles is very much something that women do. Now, there was this government program that's saying that, you know, you need to create additional an income generation program. And it was believed that, you know, they have very limited colors and they must teach them new dyes. Okay, so there was workshops done and these women were taught, and of course, chemical dyes, you know, just to increase. Earlier they were using natural dyes, you know, using materials from their surrounding areas to do their colors. So in a little while, they realized that women started getting some kind of rash. Now what happens, it's very unfortunate, but the kind of colors that reach these kind of remote areas are not necessarily the best quality. And also nobody talked, they taught them basics of how to dye, but nobody taught them that you need to wear gloves or, you know, what do you do with the water or whatever. All the issues raised, some of the issues raised by Ritu. But it was women who realized that the issues, that this water did bad things to their hands. They got, but that water drain went off to their small patch, and they all have a little patch where they grow food. And they thought this bad water was also used for their food production. Women, out of a self-realization, women said, no, we are going to stop. If there is an order, we will buy dyed yarn, but nobody in Riboy area is going to use chemical dyes. It's been a few years now. Everyone uses only natural dyes. So this is for whatever you keep. Sometimes people need to realize, and out of a realization, a lot of things come out. People who work, you know, tribal people, people who work close to the land, they do have a much better sense of protecting their environment than, say, urban people for whom water, you know, it's all a switch or a button and it's taken for granted. Another area, I'd say in Wardha, you know, which is an area, a cotton growing belt, where there have been maximum number of farmers' deaths, farmers' suicides. Lacks. For a long time, NGOs were working there trying to convince them to change to organic or use less pesticides or whatever. In recent past, a lot of the farmers, the cotton growing farmers, have decided that they will not use, they want to go back to the way they used, you know, use natural fertilizer, not use pesticide because of the deaths. They've realized, you know, again, a self-realization. So it's very good that the NGOs are working, brought in consciousness, told them alternate, improve the methods of, because with technology, with new knowledge, it has to be a marriage between traditional wisdom and new technology, new knowledge. But the fact is, the farmers are now going back to their traditional means, you know, ways of farming. Of course, they need a better yield. And people from outside who have better knowledge will teach them how to, you know, improve the yield. But they don't, because of these debts. And they know that these debts are somewhere connected to these wrong practices.
Yeah. Archana, I think the point also is that we have all these fantastic stories. We have these lived experiences from the field. In the way that sustainability cannot ever be taught to artisans and weavers in the way that they've experienced it in their lives themselves. The idea is how do we...
People can discuss these things.
More, but the other question here is that how does this become a part of an authentic storytelling that can contribute to branding and marketing positively of handlooms? I think, you know, one of the questions that I was running through in my mind was that, you know, we bring in all these marketing experts and branding experts,
but
and
we
sit them down.
Because they're not willing to listen.
But they do not have an understanding of the context. They do not have an understanding of the constituency, the rootedness of the constituency to the context, etc. And they come up with all of these fancy ideas that might look good and might even work reasonably well on paper. But the art of authentic storytelling somewhere I feel is lost out on in all of these fancy exercises. Ravi, I see, is nodding furiously. So would you want to add to that?
Yeah, I'll quickly talk about the cotton which Achanaji raised, actually, Advaita. So, yeah, I mean, a lot of cotton farmers have gone back to organic cotton. See, the problem we don't realize when we talk about handloom or a khadi, we never talk about cotton. In fact, our webinars are separate. There's a webinar for cotton farmers and a webinar for handloom separately. Yeah. So somehow when we talk about handloom, we don't connect the farmer and the viewer at all. In fact, they don't have any connection. Yeah, 97% of the cotton grown is BT cotton and one variety all across India. And today we have come to a stage where you can't make out whether the difference between a Mangalagiri and a Chanderi and a Maheshwari, because they all tend to look the same.
True.
As long as we have indigenous cotton grown in a particular area where we connect the dots of a weave, sorry, farmer to a ginner, to a slivering person, to a weaver, we will not have a heterogeneous way of making textile.
Yes.
We tend to look the same. Everything looks the same. And unfortunately, most of the weavers or master weavers who are sitting in the villages, when they come to exhibition, they get so swayed by what is market trend, they go back and start weaving the same thing, and the entire cluster will be the same thing. I mean, you go to Bagru, or whether you go to Pedna, or whether you go to other Ikat belt, they're all weaving the same thing, because it seems to be in the trend in the market. So how do you narrate an individual fabric?
It has to start from cotton. The strength is in the diversity, and that needs to come across.
The next question that I just want to ask you is that, have you come across in your experience campaigns or marketing strategies that have really in a sense borrowed or taken off from this authentic kind of a story that exists behind every craft practice? And could you share, for the benefit of our viewers, examples of the same?
Are you asking me?
Ritu, yes, it'll be nice for you to go.
I have seen designers do a great job on it. Sadly, I have not seen... So when they work with a particular technique, I have seen how well they package it, how well sold it is. So it's a great learning for all of us as to, it can be done, but it also requires deep pockets. And as Ravi said, what can the poor craftsperson do? Is he now expected to come up with this unique and amazing campaign too? That's asking for too much. But here I want to pick on something that Archana said, that where change happens is when there is long-term collaboration, when there is dedication between someone who is linking the weavers to the markets, and it's a committed relationship. It is not a relationship where you're looking for something for your next
transactional
season. Yeah, but you are invested in their lives like they are invested in your life. And that is where I have seen true change coming. And again, I will reference Chobundi here. I will reference Dastakar Andhra here. I will reference all those amazing organs. I will reference the work Archana has done, where she has brought the products of Kutch to us in Delhi and to other places. And I really saw this in the 1980s when that iconic store Gurjari started. I don't know how many remember that story, when they brought village crafts, and that was truly village crafts, because then there were not even good roads to Kutch, and they brought it to the city. And even now, when I meet people who worked with them, they say it was then that our life changed. And I saw the same thing happening with Ikat in Andhra. Because I've actually traced the history of several areas in India. And one of them was with Ikat over there. And I saw the change that happened in the 80s, when literally nobody was interested in buying their product. And when I was speaking to them, they said, when designers came in at that time, and they were so entrepreneurial that they reacted like water and parched earth. And I was told our golden period started. But there are so many stories, but sadly there aren't enough. Like it, what Ravi is saying touches on so many things, the sameness of the product. And the sameness is also there because of desperation. You come to an exhibition, you have barely any sales, and you see the stocks on the next shelf just vanishing
off.
You go back and you say, all I have done is useless now. Excuse me. We are going to do the same as the people next door. There is so much hand-holding required to say, no, you are great. This is all you need to tweak. You don't need, how marvelous if you get a great designer. Maybe just a good mentor. Maybe just someone who walks around and says, look at this again. Reevaluate this. And I think that is the amazing thing about the sector. There are hundreds and hundreds of problems. But I put a lot of faith in the hundreds and hundreds of people who love and care for it, who are, look at Ravi, look at where he's come from. He was an engineer. So
it's an amazing story. Yeah.
Amazing story. Archana could have worked with any design house anywhere in the world. She has dedicated her life to writing, reading, thinking. Look at the rest of the people. So that is wherein changes. It's with human beings and human beings connecting to each other. So reevaluate and to contextualize, because I feel we are poised. Sorry, I'm taking a bit extra time.
Ritu, please go on.
1 minute. You know, we cannot have any discussion without now talking about COVID. And it is such a dismal situation. And I was looking at a survey done called Taking the Temperature, where they said that the hardest hit has been the individual, the small and the medium scale, clearly, where all craftspeople fall. How many have shut shop? How many are struggling for their livelihood? But I want to say that the other side of COVID is that we are coming, I think, into a new age where we are now going to think, we are being forced to think about the earth, about what we are putting on our body, what we are eating, how we are living. And therein lies the strength of our handmade sector. If we are able to get certain things right, and we have to get them right, whether it's a dye or an effluent or whatever it is, we are really poised for a takeoff. And if we miss this, we will never forgive ourselves. We will be answerable to the next generation.
Very powerful, Ritu. I think that just leaves me with the one question that I wanted to put out to all of you, is that post-COVID, when markets are collapsing, we hear of declining consumer sentiment, consumption, expenditure, etc. What role do you see the government, civil society organizations working with in the craft space for many years now, and private players? What role do you see them playing in the promotion, preservation, and the penetration of handlooms in markets? And they could be joint strategies, there could be separate roles that they would be more effective in playing, but your thoughts on the same? Archana, why don't you go ahead?
Well, I think the problem the sector has faced for the longest time is that there is no long-term. It's not just to do with COVID and the problems of COVID. The sector has had issues for a long time. We began the session today with Ritu saying, the kind of percentage of sales is so minuscule. And I think this is to do because for the longest time, it was believed that this lot will be absorbed by the industry. We have no long-term plan for this sector. And if there is no no strong policy. You know, policy is what happened to communications overnight in India. Not overnight, of course, they worked for. So with the right kind of policy, you can make dramatic changes. You, this is one of the largest sector, which of course everyone knows, you know, it's next to agriculture. The two huge challenges that we face today, the glaring two challenges, are growing unemployment and climate change. This is one sector that can address both these issues. It's an eco-friendly means of production. There are millions of people, skilled people in this area. Without huge investment, you can transform this sector. So there is a huge opportunity. We have the skill sets. We have the diversity. We have, but it requires a long-term policy, not short-term. In the short-term, things cannot happen. Nothing happens. That is why there are so many failed projects. That's why you have seen that over the years, there's really been no impact. Otherwise, in the last so many years, things, this whole sector would have been transformed. So we have everything going for it. There was a time when we had the handloom board. We had the time when we had the weaver service centers, which were very vibrant bodies in every region of this country, which gave technical help, which offered design help to this handcrafted sector. Okay, we need to revamp them. Maybe obviously the way they were, things have changed. With changing times, they have to be re-looked at. But you need these bodies more than anything else, more than design intervention, more than anything. These, because this offered all of it. Product development, design, they had samples with them. So, you know, for inspiration, there were these old samples to follow. So it was very comprehensive, the kind of services that these centers offered. So it's so, so crucial that we revamp, relook at these centers with a visionary head. You need vision. You need backed with financial support, but what you need is a very strong idea, very strong vision, which is completely lacking. This can transform. It is absolutely possible with a handful of dedicated people from different fields. This sector definitely can be. And you know, millions will get jobs. Not jobs, is livelihoods, dignified livelihoods is what we should be looking at.
Thank you, Archana. Ravi? Maybe three recommendations or three areas you feel that the government, the civil society sector, and the private players can come together in outreach of handlooms to our markets.
Three is very difficult. I have a long list.
Oh, excellent. More the merrier.
So,
yes.
See, I mean, as an individual or a cooperative society, there's only so much we can do. It becomes a part of a government policy making that things has to know. Without stepping on government toes, I think most of us actually handhold many of the bureaucrats and make them very empathetic towards what we are doing. They have to realize that. Recently, I came across, I mean, Tesla has opened in Bangalore. I don't know how many
people. Yes. Yes.
So Tesla has also got $1.5 billion credit for their zero emission
regulations.
I wonder why handloom sector is not seeing that. And our hand, if you look at handloom, handicraft and khadi, now these three things have been torn apart amongst 15 different ministries.
True.
Because it's very difficult to talk to anyone because they all are so disconnected. I feel sometimes they have no idea what another person is doing. So I don't know why everything cannot come under one platform. So can we have, other thing is, can we have a better census of craftspeople? That's been a huge plus point. Can we have a decentralized system of working? See, I mean, Khadi, for example, if an entrepreneur, if a cooperative society wants to grow an organic cotton and make it into a handspun and handwoven fabric, it is simply impossible. What do you do with organic cotton? Do you have any idea what happens to organic cotton? There is absolutely no linkages at all to the fabric. There is no ginning facility. There is no slitting facility. How do you even go out there to make a fabric? So I think these are the facilities only which government can come up with. So I think it's a decentralized way of working, bringing handloom, handicraft and culture one ministry, looking at handmade of India as a green economy.
Right.
Yeah. Because our governments, when they go abroad, when they go for G7, G8 summit, they only talk about green initiatives, which happens in craft sector in India. But once they come back, they have no idea what is happening.
True. True.
So, there you go.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Ravi. Ritu, our last. Ritu, you have to unmute.
I said Ravi and Archana have said it all. And I echo them completely. But I will add just one thing. I think that if we go by our experience of our last many decades, I have a feeling that unless something drastic happens, government seems to have sort of washed its hands of us. We have been saying this for a long time and nothing has changed. So if I was to make an immediate wish list, I would say, give us a good social security net for every maker. Provide insurance for them. I'm adding to the things Ravi and Archana have said, so right. I'm not using them. So insurance, other social security net, everybody gets an artisan card which shows who they are. And so they are linked in some way to cashless health or whatever it is. So that is one aspect. And the second aspect is that I think that corporate CSR should be more closely linked to it. I feel that the time has come for us to say that let the corporations also invest. And I feel we should tap more into CSR funding. And I take this on the basis of what Ravi has said. It's decentralized. One rule cannot apply across the board. So how marvelous if we take CSR fundings or request for CSR, all corporates look at it and focus it within the region where their factories are, where their workers are.
In line with their mandate.
Yeah, in line with their mandate. And I want to add just one thing, a simple thing that I read in the paper the other day, that Unilever has said that by 2025, they are going to ensure that every supplier of theirs, including of their ice cream, right to the bottom of the chain of the supplier of what is aggregated, is they're going to ensure that they get a minimum wage. We should do the same. I mean, not tomorrow, not day after. We can give ourselves 10 years, but everybody gets the minimum wage, at least. So such a long wish list. Shreya, we could go on forever. So.
I think it's good to talk a little bit more about all of this and also put this together maybe in one place for maybe a more focused deliberation among a broader set of stakeholders. But I think the key takeaways for us then would remain that, yes, we've been talking about the difficulties of managing textiles, khadi, MSME, all lumped together in various separate categories, which seemingly have no connection between them. So I think that area for intervention is very clear. I think also MSME post-COVID released a slew of announcements that were supposed to benefit micro, small, medium enterprises. And unfortunately, the ramifications for smaller craft-based enterprises within the ambit of those announcements was quite difficult because they lumped together service and manufacturing enterprises, and they also kind of broadened the category and the scope for micro and small categories, which basically meant that our smaller craft enterprises who were already struggling to get a piece of the pie are now being further pushed into oblivion unless the government makes good on its stated intent to act on better penetration. The whole point that you made, Ritu, about social security entitlements is an interesting one, because this is something that came up very strongly immediately in the days post-lockdown, where there were desperate distress calls from weavers and artisans that we worked with, who were asking for basic ration supplies, grocery items, medical relief. And ordinarily, with the kind of entitlement situation that we have, these should have been better made available to them, at least in the times of crisis. We've recently finished a survey that looks at examining issues of uptake and access of securities and entitlements across 5 states, and the results for individual artisans are abysmal, to say the least. Finally, the whole point about census and enumeration, I think, the less said, the better. I think many organizations have been trying, particularly post-COVID, to come together to compile lists and to build an active and dynamic, comprehensive list of artisans in the country. But this is an effort that needs government backing, simply because of the kind of resources and the kind of manpower that is required for an enumeration effort of this kind. And finally, the point that you made about CSR, I think we've been seeing that a lot of the CSR resources have been redirected towards medical and COVID-related interventions the last year. And I think this is an area where we need to build conversations to highlight the craft sector as an area that is deserving of CSR funds and effort, and to lobby with companies to engage with us in a more fruitful and meaningful way. I want to end on a positive note by saying that I think it's wonderful to see all these craft networks coming up. All of these discussions that we're having on webinars, where unfortunately very few artisans themselves are called to speak for themselves. But the fact that there are a lot of more people in the sector talking, where this sector used to be at least far more territorial in the way that it operated. I think post-COVID, there is an understanding that in order to emerge stronger, one needs to come together and form new solidarities. So I think there are great efforts being made. Ravi, you've recently been part of an effort called the Indian Handmade Collective.
Yes.
And it is efforts like this, which I think are promising and keep the strategic interests of the most marginalized craftsperson at the heart. With this, I'd like to wrap up, but there are a couple of questions that I see have been flagged. So very quickly, I will direct them to all of you. Okay. Can you please help me to... I can't seem to be able to trace the questions in the chat that has been sent to me. Okay, I got it. So there is a question that comes in that says that as the demand for handlooms have changed towards more contemporary designs, this inevitably increases the importance of designers in the process of popularizing and selling handlooms. How does one include designers while ensuring the local people are protected? I think this before, when Ritu, I think you've raised this whole issue of collaboration and creation, but is there anything that you specifically want to add to this question?
Sorry, I didn't hear it. Perhaps Archana is more...
Archana, would you be able to respond to this? How does one include designers while ensuring the interests of local artisans are protected?
I mean, there is no one answer to it, because the numbers are huge. The number of artisans, designers is a very small handful. What is very interesting, I think, that is happening is a lot of young artisans themselves have become entrepreneurs and are doing some amazing new developments themselves. So I think there's a lot, there's some movement in this. So it's not, the onus is really not just on designers. Design community is really minuscule. It's tiny. They have had a role to play. They have got visibility for this sector, but it's, they have not transformed the sector. So I would balance to both, that artisans themselves are doing some really innovative, because they know they need to sell. And a lot of the young people, I think, have exposure. They're going out to the markets, they're talking to people, and that has brought in a lot of new development.
I also feel sometimes in the name of design, all kinds of atrocities are committed.
Yes, quite.
So I think we should go a little slow on design.
Yes,
you
know? Yes.
In fact, I would say the best of the designs are still in the museum. We are not, I mean, I'm very sorry to say, but fantastic design has not come across in the last 30, 40 years. The best of them are still in the museum, and that is done by craftspeople. So please leave it to them to design. Don't unnecessarily intervene. Yeah. So I think when artists design themselves in their own small setup, I think the design comes from a very pure place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because most of us who are sitting in urban, we look at Pinterest, we look at different companies abroad, we have like
right.
Japanese influence. Our thought processes are so influenced. But a lady who's actually a woman who's sitting on a loom and designing, actually it comes from an extremely pure place. I think we should honor that. You have to be very careful.
Very, very powerful, I think, statement you've made, Ravi. The next question, there have been many initiatives during the crisis for the handloom sector, like they mentioned a couple of networks that have recently come up. It has generated a lot of attention, support, and appreciation for the sector. How do we make sure that we do not lose this momentum for the future? Again, open to anybody who might want to respond.
Well, I have to say, I've been very impressed also by the number of flowers that have bloomed in the desert and how many young people have come together, deeply moved by the situation faced by practitioners, makers across. How to keep it going? I think
more people have to buy handcrafted. Yes. There is a market, there is the producer. What you need is really good markets. If every young man, person in this country, handcrafted needs to become aspirational. Buy more handcrafted. If there is work, artisans will create more.
I think also one comment on the longevity of these kind of networks and consortiums that come together with all good intent, with all their hearts in the right place, and are effective for the while that the crisis is in place. But due to various other extraneous factors, it could be a lack of funding, it could be a lack of a long-term vision, it could be a clashing of individual goals, agendas, etc. within the group, a lot of these networks also seem to fall through once the immediate crisis is over. And I think one thing that COVID has taught us is that this is a situation that is here to stay. And while we have passed the phases of relief and recovery, the longer task at hand for us is rehabilitation, revitalization, etc. So, I mean, I think all of these newly burgeoning networks also need to have an eye on the longer term aspect of things. And great as the work might have been in the interim, also look at coming together and working on longer term strategies. What would you feel about that, Ravi? In that sense, I think the India Handmade Collective is a fairly recent initiative, though I'm sure that a lot of thought must have gone into behind the same. But I mean, how are you all approaching this platform, keeping longer term interests in mind?
Three different steps. One is actually we came together, around 25 of us who are actually working with Khadar. We have all come together to make sure that we can actually have an e-commerce site and then sell through that. That's a immediate action plan which we have. And the second thing is actually education, educating customers. Like, how do we grow from one city to the other and educate people about what khadi is and how it is made and what is organic cotton, what is BT cotton, those kind of a thing. And third is advocacy. advocacy is like how we can actually look into the policy level, how we can actually look into the trademark of Khadi. So these are the three different steps which we are working on. The initial step is actually about online site, which we have just launched a month back. So, and yeah, we do have a certain strategy which we going forward. But lack of funding is my favorite subject.
I bring this up because the question here talks about not losing momentum.
Yeah. So, you need a fuel which is called money for the momentum, right? So, if you are not fueled, I don't think it will go forward much. So, I think that is where most of us struggle. You know, all of us have expertise in probably growing cotton and then we spin it and then we make fabric. Finally, when it comes to marketing, we are exhausted. And I'm sure Archana will know about it. And by the time we reach there, we are not only exhausted physically, we are exhausted with money power also. That's where we are stuck. We don't know what else to do. So I think that is a very crucial part. I think if somebody can actually help many of us just in marketing, I think the momentum will really excel. That is where we lack, finally.
Excellent. I think that is as good a point as any on which to end our deliberations. I hope that all of you tuned in found it enriching. It's lovely being part of this conversation with you, Archana, Ritu, and Ravi. And look forward to taking some of these discussions and some of these wish lists forward in our subsequent interactions. Thank you.
Thank you for being a great moderator.
Thank you. Thank you, Ritu, Archana, Ravi. Back to you, Shruti.
Well, nice seeing you all in this celebration or discussion.
Yes.
We need to have many more of these.
Yeah. I think so, Archana. Virtually as they may be in for now. So just to leave this session, concluding this panel, and before we move on to a presentation by Mr. Suvendu Raut from Access Development Services, which is scheduled around 3:20, 3:25. I urge all of you to tune in because this is an interesting study that examines the impact of COVID on lives and livelihoods in the handloom sector. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Jump into a plane and come to Delhi.
I hope that happens soon.
Come soon. And Ravi,
we'll try and make that happen soon.
Yeah.
Archana and
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.